Over the next few minutes, what I'd like to do is talk about the research paper writing process. In this PowerPoint presentation, I'm going to be taking some information from a number of different sources. Specifically, I'm going to be taking information from the fourth edition of the MLA Handbook for Writers of Research Papers by Joseph Gibaldi. I also will include some information from 10 Steps in Writing the Research Paper by Peter Markman, Allison Henney, and Roberta Markman. And then I'll close up this presentation lecture by going through some information by Lori Rosakis in her book, Writing Great Research Papers. Let me begin by talking about the writing process in general. We're all familiar that there are three phases to the writing process: the pre-writing, the drafting, and the revising phases. I want to make it clear that we typically do a lot of the research during the pre-writing phase, but I also want to stress that research needs to continue to occur during the drafting phase, and the research needs to continue into and through the revising stage. So when you're working on a research paper, you are always conducting research. Now, that begs the question, though, what is a research paper? A couple of years ago, I had my students in a freshman composition class go out and find definitions, and actually they wrote a definition essay on what is a research paper. And from our research, we came across several different definitions or terms that are used to describe what a research paper is. First and foremost, the most common definition we found in our research was that a research paper is an expanded essay. That is, you, the author, are preparing your essay, your voice, your presentation, your argument, and then you are expanding upon that argument by providing supporting evidence from outside research. In some cases, and in some majors or disciplines, the research paper is referred to as an investigative report. You might be taking a biology class, you may be taking a psychology class, and what you're doing then is conducting an investigation, and then the research paper becomes the report of the investigation that you completed. In all cases, however, a research paper is considered to be a formal presentation. In this class, we are focusing on the MLA format, the Modern Language Association, but as you're continuing through your college careers, you may use additional formats or may require such as the APA format or the Oxford format. And above all else, a research paper is evidence. According to Markman, Henney, and Markman, the research paper is evidence. It's a valid criterion for judging the disciplined work habits and the intellectual maturity of the student. In other words, when you submit your research paper to the instructor, you are providing your instructor with evidence of how well you are disciplined in your work habits to work on a long-term project and bring it to completion. And also it demonstrates the intellectual maturity of the student, because your reasoning, your thought process, your thinking is evident in the development of the paper. In other words, according to Lori Rosakis, the research paper shows your instructor that you can gather information, that you can evaluate information, and that you can synthesize information. In other words, or in short, Rosaki says that a research paper shows your instructor that you know how to think. Okay, let's go through the 10 steps of the research paper writing process. According to Markman, Henney, and Markman, the step number one is to find your subject. In doing so, you want to first consider the amount of time that you have to do the presentation. How much time do you have for the research? How much time do you have for the writing? From the moment that you get the assignment until it is due, how much time do you have? Because the subject that you choose needs to be relevant to that amount of time. In my English classes, I tend to give my students most, if not all, of a semester to work on their research paper. And so my students have a greater flexibility to go out and look for things that particularly interest them that might take additional time. Other instructors may leave the research paper until the end of the semester, or may not assign a research paper until late in the semester, and the student is then restricted in how much time the student will have, in which case you want to find a subject that you can research and write quickly. You also want to consider the length of the paper. Is the instructor asking for a 4-page research paper, or is the instructor writing asking for a 15 to 20 page research paper. The length of the paper, again, will impact your subject, because the length of the paper that will affect how much you can develop your ideas in the limited space. When you're looking to find your subject, you also want to consider the availability of research and sources. As I mentioned, they have opportunities to do interlibrary loan. They have times and opportunities to go outside of the college district, where they can go to other universities, other colleges and libraries. They have a broader availability of research. If the amount of time is limited, or if the subject is limited, you may want to consider moving on to a different subject if you're not going to have available resources to you in the amount of time that you've got. 1, 2, 3, 4, you want to consider your audience. Remember that you are an academic writer. You are a scholar writing for your professor, who is a scholar. And so you want to remember that you are writing for the professor. That is your audience. He or she is the person to whom you are addressing your research paper. And then next, you also want to consider your interests. One of the fastest ways to kill a research paper project is to take on a subject that you have no interest in. Find something that does interest you. However, Markman, Henny, and Markman also say that you should avoid any subject you will investigate with a closed mind. If you already have a very definite and secure position on abortion or the death penalty or term limits for presidential candidates, if you're already closed-minded in that, it's going to affect the kinds and the quality of the research that you look at. Research has shown that if we have a particular mindset or view of a subject, we will filter out certain types of research and resources that would contradict our point. We do not consider them. And as an academic, as a thinker, you want to take on a subject that you can look at with a sense of objectivity. Now, once you've done that, though, the next step is very easy. You want to get out and you want to get to Wikipedia or About.com or some of the online encyclopedias. You might want to go to a popular magazine and you want to read a general article about that subject that you've chosen. It's okay to do that even in a popular magazine or a website like Wikipedia, because what you're doing at this point is giving yourself a broad overview of the subject, and this step provides you with keywords that you can then use in later, more refined searches. So start with a general article just to make sure you understand generally what your topic is about. Step number 3, you want to formulate a temporary thesis. Remember, a temporary thesis, it needs to be expressed as a full sentence. It's the central point that you're arguing. And I say at this point to formulate a temporary thesis because it's the argument or the position that you anticipate being able to prove and demonstrate through your research and reasoning. However, the research and then the reasoning may change how you actually end up the paper. So this is a temporary thesis that will get you started. Lori Rozaki's book, she talks about a thesis statement that it states the topic, it shows the purpose, that is this an informative or is this an argumentative research paper? It shows the direction that you're going to be going. It is written in focused, specific language, and it is interesting, showing a clear voice and style. So says Lori Rozaki's. Step number 4, you want to prepare a preliminary bibliography. At this point, you just want to make sure that there are sufficient resources available to you to complete the research project in a timely manner. You also want to pay attention to those topics that will give you over 1 million hits in Google, because now you're dealing with a topic that is probably overused, trite, or you may be even dealing with something that's already common knowledge. So a preliminary bibliography lets you know that there is an adequate amount of research available to you without demonstrating that the topic is overused or trite. Step number 5 is when you want to start digging through those sources that you have found. You want to start taking notes. Typically, there are 3 types of notes that you'll want to keep. The first type are direct quotes. As you read through an article or a book, you may want to take down some direct quotes from the author. You only want to quote those words, phrases, lines, and passages that, according to Joseph Gibaldi, are particularly interesting, vivid, unusual, or apt. Beyond that, though, you want to just work with some general summaries of the articles that you're looking at, or paraphrases of particular points or projects. In your notes, make sure you are very clear with yourself that when you are quoting, you are quoting, and when you are summarizing or paraphrasing, you are not doing any direct quoting. You're using your own words in ideas. Now, remember, though, that even though you've written the material in your own summary or paraphrase, your own words, remember, though, that those ideas are coming from that particular source. So always keep track of your bibliographic information for all of your notes. Then step number six is to develop note cards and outlines. You want to write down the major ideas. You want to arrange your notes according to the ideas they best support. You want to try to avoid a long list of separate ideas. Remember that even though the research paper may be 15 to 20 pages in length, you are primarily going to deal only with 2, 3, or 4, maybe 5 main points in all. So you want to identify those main points at this stage, and you want to organize them into the sequence with which you want to develop them. And remember, always accept your outline, just like your thesis statement. It's a preliminary outline. And then step number 7 is finally time to write the first draft. You want to sit down at the computer or at the table with pen and paper. You want to write simply and directly. You want to use words that are accurate, suitable, and familiar. Do not repeat yourself. Don't show any particular bias in your paper. For the benefit of the reader, please mix your sentence types. There are times when a simple sentence is much stronger and much clearer than a long, involved, complex, compound sentence. And remember this, Lori Rozaki says it several times in her book, successful research papers are free of technical errors. That means your grammar, your spelling, your punctuation, your documentation of your sources is all done free of errors. Now, typically in a number of different sources, the research out there says once you've written that first draft, you want to stick it in a drawer or hide it in a folder and go take a weekend or a couple of days off before you come back to it. Because when you come back to that draft, you want to be able to come back to it with fresh eyes. So in step number 8, reviewing the text, make sure you give yourself time to become objective. That may be as quick as a night out with dinner and a movie. It may take longer than that if it's a topic that is very strongly felt by you. Allow yourself enough time, though, to rewrite. Don't take so much time becoming objective that you lose time to rewrite. And don't be afraid to make significant changes when you go back to revise. If a paragraph, if a section doesn't work, don't be afraid to get rid of it and put something next into it. And make sure you use available assistance in the form of friends and tutors that can help you review the text. Remember, you need to understand how that text is going to look to the professor who did not write it. Step number 9 is to double check your citations. Work through your paper carefully and slowly, beginning to end. Make sure that every source information is given a clear and correct citation. Double check your documentation of your bibliography, letter by letter, mark by mark, and space by space. And in your in-text parenthetical references, make sure they clearly refer to the bibliographic documentation. Step number 10 is to finalize your format. This is when you make it pretty and presentable for the instructor. You always want to use standard white 8.5 by 11 inch paper. You want to use a standard 12-point font size. Both MLA and APA formatting call for Times New Roman font. You want to double space everything. However, double check to make sure that Microsoft Word is not putting in any additional space between paragraphs. So remove any extra space between paragraphs. And also with MLA and with APA, do not justify the right margin. You want the entire document to be set up with left alignment. So, as you are preparing the paper for the instructor, here are a couple of instructor expectations. The instructor is always going to expect the text of the research paper to be free of technical or mechanical errors. you are supposed, you are expected to have taken time to make sure that document is clear and correct. Make sure that your paragraphs are arranged in a logical order, and make sure that the research paper will be enjoyable to read. It doesn't have to be entertaining. Remember, you're writing either to inform or to persuade, but it also wants to be a paper that will be enjoyable to read. In other words, the instructor doesn't want to take time to sift or work through confusing or conflated information. They don't want to read a bunch of words to make your word count. They want to read a paper that reads clearly and quickly. Okay, those are the 10 steps that come from Markman, Heine, and Markman in their book. Let me take you into Ruzaki's book on planning. She has a couple of guidelines for depending on whether you're writing a research paper over 12 weeks or whether you're writing a research paper over 4 weeks. At this point, I give my students a lot of time, so I'm going to use the larger of the two categories. First of all, you want to give yourself a good day and a half to select your topic and to craft that preliminary thesis statement. Then you want to give yourself at least 2 full days to put together your preliminary bibliography. Remember, you're not researching at this point. You're simply identifying sources, but you want to make sure you have enough sources without having a topic that has too many sources. Then give yourself another day and a half or 3 to 5 days to gather your reading notes. In other words, you want to be able to take time to go back through some of those sources, 3 to 5 days to read, to take your notes. Then you want to give yourself a full day to put together your outline. Think of your outlining as a pre-writing mechanism. You're starting to put your ideas together into your paper. After that, give yourselves another 3 to 4 days to write the first draft, and you want to throw in an extra day if you're going to write your first draft by hand. Give yourself the additional time to then type it. Give yourself 2 extra days to follow up with the research, and give yourself another 3 to 4 days to edit and revise the paper. Then that all should occur at least 2 days before you have to turn the paper in, so that you've got time to make sure your formatting, your page layout, your textual citations, your research documentation, give yourself plenty of time to do that. And Lori Rosakis makes this very clear, give yourself a couple of days of wiggle room in case you find you fall behind schedule, or as often happens, the dog eats your homework, or what I typically hear is my hard drive crashed or my printer died. So you want to give yourself times to deal with that. As I have been working on putting material into an online course, I have found that I'm constantly running into delays with the technology. It's either Microsoft Word, or it's Windows, or it's the computer, or the printer. There's always something going wrong that's going to take you time. So make sure you've planned accordingly. Okay, this was a research paper writing process. I took information from Joseph Gibaldi, Peter Markman, Allison Henney, and Roberta Markman, as well as Lori Rosakis. I've gone over the process of writing a research paper. I've talked about 10 steps, and I've talked about scheduling it. If you will follow this information quickly, you will find that you're writing a very good research paper. Thanks for listening.